Greetings, brothers, and welcome to Bible Study Fellowship, the Dallas South Evening Men's Group and Faith Bible Church in DeSoto, Texas. Ordinarily, we meet in person, but because of the weather conditions, we decided to err on the side of caution and meet on Zoom. My name is Deron Hill. I am your teaching leader, and I am also my brother's keeper. And brothers, I just want to encourage you to stay warm. Let those faucets drip on the inside so that hopefully the pipes won't freeze and we can get through this whole winter event unscathed. And I look forward to seeing you guys in person, hopefully next week. Announcements. Brothers, I hope you got your email last week regarding the Texas Rangers Fellowship. It's on March the 30th. It's at 6:05. That is a Saturday. The information was emailed to you last week. Please respond quickly and go ahead and get your payment in. It's $58 per person. We're encouraging you to invite other men, particularly men who are not in Bible study fellowship, so that we can try to spread the love of BSF and perhaps encourage brothers to join us for that last month of our study this year. Because this is March the 30th, and we'll have about five more Mondays after that in our study. So we'd like to get some guys to join us for the rest of this year, and hopefully they'll come back also for the study of Revelation in the fall. But please respond quickly. All right, brothers, and remember, BSF does depend on your financial support. You can give online or in person when we return, or you can give by mail. All right, brothers, if you have not done so, go ahead and open your Bibles to our text for this week. We're still in the wonderful book of John, lesson 15. We're in chapter 11. Jesus displays power over death by resurrecting Lazarus from the grave. Jesus displays power over death by resurrecting Lazarus from the grave. Our aim is to cause the audience to learn that believers in Jesus live even though they die. Believers in Jesus live even though they die. We have three divisions of chapter 11, verses 1 through 16 is our first division, 17 through 34 is our second division, and 45 through 57 is our final division. All right, brothers, Jesus reminds us, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So before we dive in, let's open with a word of prayer. And Lord, I just pray, Lord, that you would decrease me, that you would increase in our eyes. Lord, help us to understand this text and understand that you are the resurrection and the life and what that means for us today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, brothers, let's go ahead and dive in. So as we begin John chapter 11, a fairly short period of time has passed since the events of the first 39 verses of chapter 10. Those verses in chapter 10 occurred immediately after Jesus pardoned the adulterous woman and gave sight to the man born blind. By doing this, Jesus exposed the hypocrisy of the religious leaders and contrasted them with himself. Using shepherd talk, Jesus has called himself the good shepherd who would lay down his life for the sheep. Legitimate shepherds would lead those in their care as they followed Jesus. And then there were false shepherds who would also try to enter the sheep pen by some other way other than Jesus. This caused division among the religious leaders, and many wanted to seize and kill Jesus. So Jesus and his disciples left Judea and went back to the region where John the Baptist was baptizing. And based on the particular festival Jesus was in Judea for, we know that this happened in winter during December. Jesus is quickly marching towards the cross. The very next Passover, which coincides with what we call Easter, will be when Jesus is crucified. And since we know Easter always occurs in the spring between March, late March and April, we know that when Jesus left Judea to go back across the Jordan, his crucifixion is less than 4 months away. Our good shepherd, Lamb of God, our transformer, our healer, spiritual ophthalmologist, partner of our sins, Jesus is in full court press mode. He is building his case for who he is in such a way that only hearts that are hardened to God and the truth will reject him. Beginning in verse 1 of chapter 11, we are introduced to a man named Lazarus and his sisters, Mary and Martha. They lived in Bethany, which is in Judea, the region Jesus left in December because the leaders wanted to kill him. John includes that Mary was the one who anointed Jesus with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. The details of that event are in chapter 12. Mary and Martha sent a message to Jesus, and this family was very close to Jesus, and we will see that they had been sitting under Jesus's teachings. The message they sent said, "Lord, the one you love is sick." So we see that they were friends of Jesus, but Jesus was still Lord to them. Notice they did not even say their brother's name. They knew Jesus would know who they were speaking of because Jesus is all-knowing. In fact, Jesus knew Lazarus was sick before he received the news. Actually, before Jesus created Lazarus, Jesus knew this day was coming, and Jesus will soon tell us why. Their reaching out to Jesus was merely a product of their faith in him. In verse 4, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death, but it is for the glory of God, so that the Son of Man may be glorified through it." And with these words, Jesus has established a pattern. We saw it with the man born blind, and now we see it with Lazarus. Their difficulty was ultimately so that God would be glorified through it. So if you're a believer in Jesus, I encourage you to persevere and look for God's glory, even in the most difficult of circumstances. Verses 5 and 6 seem to show a contradiction. They say, Jesus loved Martha, Mary, and Lazarus, so he stayed 2 more days where he was. Say, what? You mean Jesus didn't get on the first camel he saw and rode into Bethany? Nope. And the word "so" at the very beginning of this verse 6, "so he remained there where he was 2 more days," implies that it was out of Jesus's love for Martha, Mary, and Lazarus that he stayed put for 2 more days. But the words also relate back to the Father and Son being glorified through Lazarus's situation. Had Jesus not delayed, but rushed back and healed Lazarus before he died, God would have received less glory because Jesus had already healed many people. And when Jesus healed these folks, including the man born blind, those people were not named. We don't know the name of the Samaritan woman, the royal official whose son Jesus healed, the lame man. We don't know their names. But because of Jesus's desire to bring greater glory to God, the Father, and the Son, Jesus would also make sure that his dear friends, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, would be forever etched in Scripture by name. He had a special love for them. And of course, Jesus knows all. He foreknew that, that the events of chapter 11 would take place in this particular way and would set the stage for the events of chapter 12, which we will discuss next week. So please make sure you come back. So after 2 days, Jesus tells his disciples that they are going to Judea. And the disciples said, "Oh, heavens no. Jesus, do you recall that the Jews were trying to stone you?" Jesus was completely unfazed. He was trying to eat his soul food, which we already know is doing the will of the Father. Jesus asked a rhetorical question. He said, "Aren't there 12 hours in a day? If anyone walks during the day, he doesn't stumble because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks at night, he stumbles because the light is not in him." These words are simply another way of Jesus communicating what he did in chapter 9, verses 4 and 5, when he said, "We must do the works of him who sent me while it is still day. Night is coming when no one can work." And this is the same message he gave in chapter 4 when he said, "The harvest is right now." So if you are a believer in Jesus and you have breath in your lungs and are still capable of serving, the time to do it is right now. Because we don't know when our daytime will end, when our earthly lives will be over. We are not to worry about those who oppose us because the one we serve is greater than anyone who is against us. Then Jesus tells his disciples in verse 11, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going to wake him up." The disciples misunderstood Jesus just like I would have. Then Jesus told them plainly that Lazarus has died. Now, this brings up an interesting observation. What God calls death and what people call death are two completely different things. What we call death is actually physical death. When this body stops breathing and the heart stops beating, we say a person's dead. Jesus says if that person is a believer in him, that person is not dead. He or she is merely asleep. Biblically speaking, death is being separated from God. Now, if we go all the way back to Genesis chapter 2, before there was ever any death of any kind, God told Adam that he could eat freely of any tree in the garden except for the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For on the day you eat of it, you will surely die. But we know the account. Adam and Eve ate from the tree, and Adam lived to be over 900 years old and had a whole bunch of kids after they fell into sin. But God's word is true. The day they ate of the forbidden tree, they died spiritually. They were separated from God, evicted from the Garden of Eden, and removed from God's presence. So whether you are alive or dead is not a function of your heartbeat. It is a function of your relationship or lack thereof with God. So an unbeliever who attends the funeral of a believer is dead while the person in the casket is very much alive. So in the very next division, in verse 26, when Jesus says believers in him never die, I will have already explained what he means. But Jesus in verse 14 puts this into human terms for us mere mortals to understand. He said, Lazarus has died, but I'm glad for you that I was not there so that you may believe. Let's go to him. So Jesus adds even more insight into why he waited. Waiting until Lazarus was dead and buried would bring greater glory to God the Father, God the Son, etch the names of Martha, Mary, and Lazarus in Scripture, and it would increase the faith of believers in Jesus. I mean, it's one thing to heal a sick person, but raising a dead man is proof beyond any doubt that Jesus is the authorized representative of God. In fact, every miracle John records, and in fact, his entire gospel was written for the same reason Jesus delayed in going to Lazarus, so that people would believe that Jesus is the Christ. And that brings us to our principle. And that is, God's timing is always perfect. That's good news. God's timing is always perfect. The events of our text are occurring no more than weeks before Jesus' crucifixion. Lazarus' illness, the subsequent death, the message sent by Lazarus' sisters to Jesus out of their faith in Jesus, Jesus' delay, the people who believed across the Jordan, and so many other things had to occur perfectly in God's timing so that God's glory was maximized, as well as the opportunity for growth in the faith of believers and for unbelievers to come to believe. All had to be timed perfectly according to God's good and perfect will. And that brings us to our application question. And that is, how are you challenged or encouraged by God's perfect timing? How are you challenged or encouraged by God's perfect timing? As mere men, we are challenged and limited by time and space. So reconciling our limitations and trusting in a God who is not bound by time or space is difficult at times. Even Father Abraham struggled in this way. He looked at God's promises of a child and considered his and Sarah's age, and what he saw with his human eyes led him to Hagar and Ishmael and all of the subsequent challenges that have emerged since. Additionally, we go through life with seemingly random events occurring with little regard to God's sovereign hand in our circumstances. The woman at the well meeting Jesus was not by chance. It was God's sovereignty and perfect timing. Jesus encountering the men who would say yes to his invitation to come and see and become his disciple. Those were not chance meetings. However and whenever you came to Bible study fellowship was not by chance or by luck. It was God's perfect timing. As believers in Jesus, we take comfort in knowing that God's perfect and sovereign timing has the goal of maximizing his glory and your faith. This account would impact the faith of those who witnessed the events of chapter 11, and it impacts our faith today. So our challenge is to be like Martha and Mary. Invite Jesus to enter whatever circumstance we face, and he will respond in his own perfect timing. And that brings us to our next division. We are told in verses 17 through 19 that by the time Jesus arrived, Lazarus had been in the tomb for 4 days. And since Bethany was close to Jerusalem, many Jews were visiting Martha and Mary to express their condolences. John tells us that Martha went out to meet Jesus when she got word that he was near. Martha's first words reveal her faith and her flesh. They should remind us of ourselves. She said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Her first sentence reveals the closeness of her relationship with Jesus and the fact that she knew Jesus could heal the sick, which she had likely witnessed. She continued, "Yet even now, I know that whatever you ask from God, he will give you." Now, Martha did not know that Jesus was about to raise Lazarus from the grave. In her mind, Lazarus's death was a foregone conclusion. She is a lot like we are today when we lose a loved one who is a believer. We mourn. We know God has the power to heal the sick, but we submit to the decision he makes, even when it includes physical death. And by faith, we trust that our loved one is in the very presence of Jesus and we will see him or her again. It causes us to mourn with hope rather than to mourn with despair. In verse 23, Jesus does not directly address what Martha has said to him. He merely says, "Your brother will rise again." Martha then lets us know that she has been sitting under Jesus' teachings, and she repeats back to Jesus what she understands about the resurrection. And it is the same thing Jesus told the crowd in John chapter 6 when he was speaking to the people he had fed with the 2 fish and 5 loaves the day before. Several times in John chapter 6, Jesus called himself the bread of life and said those who believe in him would have eternal life and be raised up on the last day. Martha had learned this from Jesus, and in our text, she expresses her belief in Jesus. She told Jesus, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus responds with some deep biblical truth that on his face may have been hard for people to understand, but he is about to make it crystal clear. He told Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me, even if he dies, will live. Everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" Now, I've already covered the difference in what death means to humans compared to what death means to God. When believers in Jesus experience physical death, there is no interruption in their right relationship with God. They don't die spiritually. Death is merely the vehicle that God uses to bring them home. He removes them from these sinful earthbound bodies that are limited to time and space and brings their soul and spirit into his glorious presence. What our physical eyes see on earth is a corpse that remains and is very dead because there is no longer a soul in it telling it what to do. But the true essence of the life that previously resided in that body is very much alive in the presence of God. So we can understand Jesus's words to mean the one who believes in Jesus, even if he dies physically, will live. Everyone who lives and believes in Jesus will never die spiritually. Believers will never be separated from God because, like Jesus told us in chapter 10, no one can snatch us out of his hand. Jesus asked Martha, "Do you believe this?" And despite her grief, her flesh, all of the very raw emotions she was feeling, and she just made her complete, she made a complete fresh profession of her faith. She proclaimed, "Yes, Lord, I believe you are the Messiah, the Son of God who comes into the world." At this point, she stopped blaming Jesus for not being there when Lazarus was sick. She held fast to who she knew Jesus is, and she knew Jesus loved her, Mary, and Lazarus, and that Jesus was worthy of her complete trust. After her profession of faith in who Jesus is, she left to go get her sister Mary. When we see in verse 30 that Jesus still had not entered the town, he is still delaying, and we see at least part of the reason why. He wanted Mary and the Jews who were comforting her to witness the miracle he was about to perform. The text tells us that as Mary went to see Jesus, the Jews who were who were there at her at the house followed her, thinking that she was heading back to the tomb. Their desire to comfort Martha and Mary would cause them to witness a life-changing event that would cause many of them to become followers of Jesus. The first thing they witnessed is in verse 32. They saw Mary fall at the feet of Jesus, call him Lord, and say, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died." Apparently, Mary and Martha had discussed this because they both greeted Jesus with the same words. She was in tears. And verse 33 says that when Jesus saw her crying and the Jews who were with her were crying, he was deeply moved in his spirit and troubled. In that moment, I imagine Jesus saw believers and unbelievers powerless against death. He was seeing in his flesh and spirit in real time the damage that sin has done to mankind, people he loved so much, people he was willing to die for. Jesus asked, "Where have you put him?" And they told Jesus to come and see. Jesus, the unique Savior who is fully God and fully man, he wept as he personally, in the flesh, experienced the pain and despair that sin had brought into his creation. The Jews noted that Jesus really loved Lazarus, and it was clear that they knew who Jesus was because they knew about Jesus giving sight to the blind man no more than a few weeks earlier. Some made the statement, "He gave sight to a blind man. Couldn't he have kept this man from dying?" Jesus told them to remove the stone. Martha was very practical in her response. She said, "Lord, he's been dead 4 days. He stinks." Jesus reminded her, if she believed, she would see God's glory. God always requires an affirmative act that is consistent with our faith in him in order to see him work. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. The servants at the wedding had to fill large jars with water. The lame man had to pick up his mat and walk. The blind man had to wash in the pool, and here the people had to roll back the stone. God partners with believers to reveal the otherwise unbelievable. So after the people exercised enough faith to remove the stone, they heard Jesus audibly pray to the Father, thanking the Father for always hearing Jesus' prayer and providing the opportunity for the crowd to believe in Jesus. And after this prayer, Jesus, in a loud voice, shouted, "Lazarus, come out." And Lazarus did exactly that. He exited the tomb, bound and wrapped in linen cloth. Jesus told the people, "Unwrap him and let him go." And that brings us to our principle. And that is, resurrection power only exists in the person and power of Jesus. Resurrection power only exists in the person and power of Jesus. In this division, we see Jesus pointing us to his still future death and resurrection. Once he is crucified and rises again, then those who place their faith in him will have the additional knowledge that Jesus raised Lazarus and then raised himself. So there is a legitimate basis to trust he can do it for me. He can and will raise believers up on the last day, just like he said he would. Additionally, we see Jesus' love and concern for Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, but also for the Jews who still did not believe. For Mary and Martha, Jesus wanted to grow their faith. And for the unbelievers, Jesus wanted them to believe in him. There were enough people who exercised enough faith to roll back a stone too heavy for Mary or Martha to move. And because of that mustard seed of faithful obedience, they got to witness Jesus reveal himself as the resurrection and the life. Unfortunately, however, just like people today, Mary, Martha, everyone there would eventually experience physical death. And for Lazarus, it would be round two. But for those who chose faith in Jesus, they would prepare for death a lot differently. You see, the love of Jesus and the resurrection power of Jesus should cause us to approach physical death much differently. We don't view death as the end. Actually, it is a new beginning to experience the fullness of eternal life. Knowing that we will one day die physically to live eternally in the presence of God should cause us to desire in our hearts to live lives that are pleasing to the Lord, pleasing to the one who is responsible for providing eternal life to us as a gift. Our loving desire to serve Jesus flows from his love for us and his victory over sin, death, the grave, and the enemy. Jesus' victory over death is so complete that we never really die. Our souls go immediately to be with Jesus, according to 2 Corinthians 5:8, and our bodies simply sleep in Jesus until they are resurrected from the grave and forever glorified. And that brings us to our application question. And that is, how does the resurrection power of Jesus impact your faith walk? How does the resurrection power of Jesus impact your faith walk? As you ponder this question, we will go to our next division. And we, here we go, okay. We see that for many of the Jews who came initially to comfort these grieving sisters, they saw Jesus raise Lazarus from the grave and they believed in Jesus. They decided, okay, he gave sight to the man born blind not long ago. And now in our very presence, he raised a dead man to live again. That's enough for me. Whoever he claims to be, he is, and many believe. However, John begins verse 46 with a big old but. John writes, but some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. They were snitches. And it appears that Jesus raising Lazarus did not happen on the Sabbath, so they could not play the Sabbath card. So the leaders, the chief priests, Pharisees, and the Sanhedrin convened a meeting to discuss what they should do about Jesus. The words that John records are, what are we going to do since this man is performing many signs? Those words are truly an indictment of the hearts of these men. They recognized Jesus's works as signs, but they wanted to suppress the truth. I imagine there were a few Nicodemuses in the meeting, but they kept their faith to themselves. They plotted, saying, if we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will take away our place and our nation. These men did not consider prophecy or the significance of the signs Jesus was performing. They were more concerned about trying to hold on to the limited political power they had under Roman rule. Then the high priest Caiaphas chimed in with these prophetic words. He said, it was better for one to die for the people rather than the whole nation to perish. As the high priest uttered these words, he had no idea just how true those words would be. Jesus would, in fact, be the one person who would die for the sins of the entire world. So these men, who were the religious leaders of this nation, made the decision to kill the one who was performing what they recognized as signs because it was in their political best interest, so they thought. If that does not encourage you to vote for godly leaders, I don't know what does. In fact, the evil in the hearts of these leaders will also cause them to seek to kill Lazarus because everywhere Lazarus went, people were believing in Jesus. Just imagine going to Lazarus's funeral one day and a week and a half later, you see Lazarus in line ordering a Big Mac. You know, so folks were starting to believe in Jesus because his resurrection power had a walking, talking example from what was apparently a well-known family in the community. We will get into the plot to kill Lazarus next week, but because of the plot to kill Jesus, he stayed out of the public eye. John tells us that Jesus went to Ephraim and stayed there with his disciples. Jesus would not return to Jerusalem until Passover, which was the time for his crucifixion, no more than a few weeks away. Our text ends with Passover upcoming. People were traveling to Jerusalem to go to the temple, and the people were looking for Jesus with specific orders to report any sightings of Jesus to the religious leaders. And that brings us to our principle. And that is, faith in Jesus is the access point to resurrection power. Faith in Jesus is the access point to resurrection power. We see basically two responses to Jesus in our text. Belief and unbelief. There is no third option. You say, well, I have not made a decision yet. If you do not believe that Jesus is the Son of God and Messiah, then you have chosen unbelief. And there is something about unbelief that hardens the heart to Jesus, even in the face of evidence as to who he is. Faith caused Mary to fall to Jesus's feet and call him Lord in spite of her grief. Faith caused believers to roll back the stone, while those who chose unbelief rolled a proverbial stone over their hearts and even desired to kill the Savior. Those with faith believed and called him Lord and likely went on to share Jesus with others. Those who chose unbelief sought other unbelievers to plot against Jesus. Those with faith would have their spiritual eyes open to experience the supernatural with the kingdom of heaven perspective. Those without faith could only see with their physical eyes and only saw their position in human politics. The truth is, what we see Jesus do with Lazarus in a physical bodily resurrection, Jesus does in the spiritual for those who believe in him. Through faith in Jesus, he has called us out of the grave. Before coming to Jesus, we were walking, talking, spiritually dead men. But through faith in Jesus, we are now alive and will be forever. We will never experience spiritual death because we are forever in a right relationship with God. And as Jesus told us in John 10, 27, no one can snatch us out of his hand. We are held firmly by the good shepherd who laid down his life for his sheep. Like the brother in chapter 9, we were once blind, but now we see. By faith, like the woman caught in adultery in John chapter 8, we are forgiven and will not face condemnation. By what we read in John chapter 7, we have by faith realized our thirst and came to Jesus, and we now have streams of living water. We will live forever because by faith we have chosen to consume the bread of life, as described in John chapter 6. And by faith, like the lame man in chapter 5, we are able to do what Jesus has called us to do. We can pick up our proverbial mat and walk so that God is glorified through us. And by faith in Jesus, we have the desire to do the will of God, which Jesus calls food in chapter 4. And by faith, as Jesus told Nicodemus in chapter 3, we have been born of the Spirit and we have eternal life. And like the water Jesus turned into wine in chapter 2, by faith, we have been transformed from something ordinary in the natural to something extraordinary in the supernatural. And as John wrote in chapter 1, verse 12, by faith, we have the right to be called children of God. And back to chapter 11, it is by faith that Jesus is who the Bible says he is, that we will experience his resurrection power. If your faith is in yourself, if your faith is in a statue made with human hands or some so-called religious person who is still dead in their grave, then I can assure you that unless you come to Jesus, you will not experience his glorious resurrection on that last day. In fact, and we will go into depth in this in our study of Revelation, those who do not have a right relationship with God, those who die in their sin, they will experience a type of resurrection that is described in Revelation chapter 20. It is called the Great White Throne Judgment. And there the text tells us that everyone whose name is not written in the book of life, that's the book that contains the names of all believers in Jesus, they will be judged by their works and ultimately cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. But because Jesus paid it all, this second death is completely unnecessary. Believers in Jesus, those named in the book of life, will be victorious. And according to Revelation 3:5, the Lord will never erase their name from the book of life, and they will be acknowledged by Jesus before God the Father. They have and will have eternal life. And as Jesus has told us, he personally, our good shepherd, the one whose hands we cannot be snatched out of, the one who is the resurrection and the life, he will personally raise us up on the last day. And that brings us to our application question. And that is, do you have eternal life insurance? Do you have eternal life insurance? You know, Whether it's term life or whole life or universal life, you can shop around for the best insurance rates, but nothing covers you and your family like Eternal Life Insurance. Now, I assure you, you cannot get this from a gecko or a brother named Jake. In fact, you can't even buy it. The premium has been paid in full on the cross by the finished work of our good shepherd who laid down his life for some sheep right here in DeSoto and Waxahachie, Texas. And this policy comes with a resurrection rider. You don't need a physical exam to get it, but you do need a spiritual exam. All you have to do is recognize that you are a sinner in need of a savior and believe that Jesus, because of his finished work on the cross, is that savior. And brothers, today we're going to close out a little differently. We're going to close out with a song that captures the essence of our text tonight. And after that, you will go into your groups according to the instructions that you've already received. God bless you.
The news came to Jesus. Please come fast. Lazarus is sick, and without your help, he will not last. Mary and Martha watched their brother die. They waited for Jesus. He did not come, and they wonder why. The death watch was over. Buried 4 days. Somebody said, he'll soon be here. The Lord's on his way.
His way is God's way, not yours or mine.
He's 4 days late. He's still on time.
He's still
on time. Oh, my God is great. When he's 4 days late, he's still on time. For it, he's still on time.
Well, brothers, I hope that was a blessing to you as it was to me. Let's pray. And Heavenly Father, we pray for vibrant discussion in the groups. I pray, Lord, that you be glorified. And Lord, I just pray, Lord, for your special protection for our lives and health and property, Lord, during this cold snap that we're having here in Dallas. And we pray, Lord, that you would bring us back next week safe and sound. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, brothers. We'll see you next time.